Welcome back, everyone. In this segment, we're going to look at the cryptographic primitives that are needed to make a blockchain work. So let's dive right in. The first cryptographic primitive I want to tell you about is what's called a cryptographic hash function. So a hash function basically is an efficiently computable function that maps a large domain into a small range. So you can see here the domain M is much, much larger than the range T. The picture you should have in mind is that we might be hashing megabytes of data, so very, very large amounts of data that are provided as input to the hash function. They get hashed, but no matter how much data is provided, the hash function always only outputs 32 bytes in this case. Yeah, so large amounts of data come in, a fixed amount of data comes out, very short 32-byte digest. 32 bytes is 256 bits. And so we say that in this case, the range is 0, 1 to the 256, which means all 256 bits binary strings. Yeah, and again, 256 bits is 32 bytes. So we'll be thinking of these hash functions as outputting 32 bytes for the rest of this segment. Now, a key concept in studying cryptographic hash function is what's called collision resistance. So to explain collision resistance, let's first of all understand what is a collision. So a collision for a hash function h from m to t is basically a pair of distinct inputs x and y such that h of x is equal to h of y. So we say that x collided with y because h of x is equal to h of y. Now, because the domain is so much larger than the range, right, there are many, many more messages in the input space than in the output space. Clearly, by the pigeonhole principle, there are going to be many collisions, right? There are going to be many inputs, x and y, that happen to collide just because the range is so much smaller than the domain. The point of a collision-resistant hash function is that even though there is a huge number of possible collisions, it's hard to point to even one explicit collision. Yeah, it's hard to find even a single pair, x, y, that happens to collide for the hash function h. So if that's true, if the hash function h has this property, we say that h is collision resistant, and we'll write that h is a CRH. CRH just stands for collision resistant hash. So you might be wondering, well, what's an example of a collision resistant hash function? And the canonical example is this hash function called SHA-256. This is a fixed hash function that's actually specified in a federal standard. What it does is it takes an arbitrary amount of data, well, up to 2 to the 64 bytes, so potentially megabytes, even petabytes of data, and it always maps them to a 256-bit output, which again means 32 bytes. Okay, so again, huge amounts of data come in, 32 bytes come out. And the function is collision resistant, which means that it's difficult to find two distinct messages that happen to map to the same 32-byte digest. Now, if you want to see how collision resistance is built and how SHA-256 works, I'm not going to describe that here, but I would refer you to my crypto MOOC. You can take a look at the lecture on collision resistance, and there's a lot of information there on why the hash function is built the way it is and how these collision resistant hash functions actually operate. But for now, we'll take SHA-256 as a given, and we'll assume it's collision resistant. So there are many applications for cryptographic hash functions. They're useful in proof of work consensus, which we're not going to talk about here. Instead, I want to talk about an application for collision resistance that has to do with committing to large amounts of data. Okay, so imagine Alice has a file or maybe a message, which we'll denote by M. So she has a fairly large amount of data. And what she will do is she will commit to this data by publishing a hash of the message M. So the hash is only 32 bytes, so it's a very, very short commitment to possibly megabytes of data. And we want to say that this little digest H actually commits her to the message that she just committed to. So what does that mean? Suppose Bob actually has the commitment. So Bob has the little h output of the hash function. And then later, Alice sends to Bob the message M prime, claiming that this is the message that she actually committed to. Okay? Well, Bob can check that h of M prime is equal to little h. And the claim is that if the hash function is collision resistant, then if this equality holds, then Bob is convinced that the message M prime really is the message that Alice committed to. Let's say that more precisely. If H is a collision resistant hash and H of M prime is equal to little h, then Bob is convinced that M prime is equal to M. Yeah, and why is that true? If somehow Alice was able to find M and M prime such that H of M is equal to H of M prime, but M is not equal to M prime, well, that would be a collision for the hash function H, but because we assumed H is collision resistant, that's going to be difficult for her to do. So what this means is, again, that if Alice publishes a collision-resistant hash of her message M, then that little h, that little hash value, little h, is committing her to the message M, and the only way that she can find an M prime that maps to little h is if M prime is equal to M. Okay, so we say that this is what's called a binding commitment to the message M, because once Alice publishes little h, she can no longer change her mind about little m. Now, one thing that I want to point out is that this sort of commitment is not a hiding commitment, in the sense that the hash of the message m might actually leak information about m. Yeah? And so this is not a hiding commitment. It's not hiding the message, but it is binding, in the sense that once Alice commits, she can no longer change her mind about the contents of the message m. So let's look at a more interesting application, which is committing to not just a single message, but in fact a list of messages. And just looking ahead, the list of messages we're going to be interested in committing to is going to be a list of transactions in a block. So suppose we have M1 to MN. These are N different messages that, let's say, they form a list, and we'll call this list S. Now, our goal is to build a commitment scheme with the following property. So Alice is going to publish a short binding commitment to S. Okay, so once she publishes the commitment, she can no longer change her mind about the committed messages. And this commitment is going to be this short digest. So it, again, has to be just 32 bytes. Now, again, as before, Bob is going to obtain this commitment value. So he's going to obtain little h. And then later on, Alice would like to prove that the message at position I is equal to MI. And to do that, she's going to send to Bob the message MI, along with some sort of a proof, which we'll call pi I. Pi stands for proof, that this proof pi I will convince Bob that the message at position I, the committed message at position I, is really MI. Yeah, so S of I is equal to MI. To do that, Bob is going to run through some verification algorithm. The verification algorithm is going to take the commitment, the index, the candidate message, MI, and the proof, and is either going to accept or reject that proof. From a security point of view, we'd like to say that an adversary cannot find a list S, an index I, a message M, and a proof pi, such that M is not equal to S of I, and yet the proof is accepted by the verification algorithm. Yeah, this should be hard, and if that's true, then we say that this is a valid commitment to a set that allows opening of elements in this set. So how do we do this? So how do we commit to a set and then later open up only one element in the set using a very short proof? So the trick to do this is what's called a Merkle tree. Okay, and this is due to Ralph Merkle already back in 1989. So it's an old idea, but this idea is so important that it's now used everywhere in the blockchain space. So let's see how this works. So we're going to commit to a list of size n. Here we'll assume we have only 8 elements, so n is equal to 8. We want to commit to these 8 messages. And then we want to be able to later prove that entry number I in the list is equal to mi. So the way we're going to do that is by committing, by forming a Merkle tree, and we're going to produce this short commitment h, which is, again, just 32 bytes. Nothing more. Very, very short commitments, even though we might be committing to a million elements where each element is a megabyte long. The commitment overall is just 32 bytes. And the way we do that is basically by forming this Merkle tree. So a Merkle tree is basically a tree of hashes where you can see that we're hashing all bottom pairs. Then we're hashing all hashes. Yes, so that's how we get the second layer of hashes. Then we hash again all hashes, and then finally, once we're done to a single hash, that's going to be the final commitment that we're going to send over to Bob. Okay, so let's just give names to wires. So we'll call them y1, y2, up to y6. These are the internal hash values in the Merkle tree. And now, let's suppose that we want to prove that S4 is equal to M4. Okay, so we want to open up the fourth element in our list and then provide a proof that in fact M4 really is the thing that we committed to at position 4. Well, the way we're going to do that is using the following proof. The proof is going to consist of the element M3, Y1 and Y6. So let me show you what they are. So here are the elements, and what they are is really you look at the path from M4 all the way to the root, and for each element along this path, you provide the sibling of that element. So for M4, we provide a sibling, namely M3. For Y2, we provide a sibling, namely M1. And for Y5, we provide a sibling, namely Y6. So the proof consists of these three elements. More generally, if we had a tree with N leaves, the depth of the tree would be log base 2 of N. So the proof would consist of log base 2 of N hashes, which is really quite remarkable because that means it's a really short proof. Think about a tree that contains a million elements. So imagine we're committing to a million elements. Well, log base 2 of a million is around 20. So that means that the proof for proving that M4 is really what it's claimed to be, the proof would only contain 20 hashes because log of a million is around 20. Okay, so using a very short proof, we can prove that M4 is the value that's claimed. And now how does Bob actually verify the proof? Okay, so again, we want to prove that S4 is equal to M4. Well, what Bob would do is the following. It's kind of basically following up the path. So he would take the claimed M4 along with the element M3 from the proof and hash those together. That would give it a candidate for Y2. Then it would take Y2 and hash it along with the element Y1 from the proof. That would give it a candidate for Y5. It would take Y5 and hash it along with Y6 from the proof, and then Y5 and Y6 together will give it a candidate H prime for the Merkle output, and then it will check if H is equal to H prime, it will accept, otherwise it will reject. Okay, so not only is the proof contains only log n hash values, the verifier, Bob, can verify that the proof is correct by literally computing only log n hashes. So very, very fast verification of these Merkle proofs. Okay, so again, very easy way to prove that a particular element in the committed set is what we claim it to be. So in this case, M4 is the M4 that we claim it to be. The proof contains only log n elements, and it also only takes log n hash operations to verify this proof. Okay, so one last time. So Alice committed to a list of a million values. Well, in this case, 8 values, but in general, a very large list of values. And then she can later open up any element in that list and prove that that element is consistent with the public commitment to the entire list. Yeah, again, in this case, H was the public commitment to the entire list. And Alice can prove that M4 is, in fact, the fourth element in the list that she committed to. And the proof is really short. It only contains 3 values, and that's it. Okay. So you can prove a security theorem that shows that this scheme, in fact, is secure. In particular, if H is a collision-resistant hash, it's fairly easy to prove that, in fact, the adversary cannot come up with a list S, an index I, a candidate M, and a proof pi, such that M is not the ith element in the list, and yet this verification procedure will accept M as if it were the ith element. This is actually a good exercise to try and prove yourself. If you want to prove this, try to prove the contrapositive, namely, if Alice could come up with such a four-tuple, then she would be able to break collision resistance of H. Yeah, it's a good, cute exercise to do, and I recommend that you try to prove this yourself. So what is this all useful for? So we're able to commit to a large list of values and then later open a particular element in the list and prove that element was opened correctly. Why is this useful? Well, it turns out it comes up all over the place. Yeah. So for example, when writing a block of transactions, we're going to keep the only thing we're going to write to the actual blockchain is going to be a commitment to the block of transactions. But later on, anyone can prove that any particular transaction is in the block by simply providing a Merkle proof that that transaction is included in that commitment. Okay, so it's an easy way to commit to a large list of transactions in a block using a very short commitment. And then if you're interested in a particular commitment in that block, you can actually prove that that commitment was included in that block. So really, when you think about what a blockchain is, it really is just a bunch of Merkle root commitments. Okay, so really a blockchain contains a bunch of block headers. So here you can see that there's a Merkle root commitment to a tree of transactions that are committed to in this block. Okay, but the block header really just includes the Merkle root. There's some other data which we won't get into, but that's not important. The main important thing here is that the block header contains a Merkle commitment to a list of transactions. The next block basically contains a hash of the previous block header, just the block header, and then there's a Merkle root to another set of transactions. And so on and so forth, right? The next block contains a hash of the previous block header. This hash chain is what forms the actual blockchain. But the point is that every block header contains basically a Merkle commitment to its transactions. And then if at any point in time I want to show that transaction 2 is really on the blockchain, all I need to do is just provide a Merkle proof to this Merkle root that transaction 2 is in fact the value that I claim that it is. Yeah, so as it says here, Merkle proofs are used to prove that a transaction is on the blockchain. All right, so this is kind of the abstract view you should have of what a blockchain is. And so this is all I wanted to say about cryptographic hash functions. In the next segment, we're going to talk about digital signatures, and we're going to see how they're used to authorize transactions. Okay, see you in a few minutes.